Morning. I'm Reverend Joe Trapanski. I've been leading worship today. It's good morning not only to those of you who are here in the sanctuary, but to those of you who are watching us on live stream, and to those of you, thank you. I was trying to figure out what Peggy was doing down there. Let's do that again. I'm Reverend Joe Trapanski. Welcome to worship today. To you here in the sanctuary, to those of you who are watching us via live stream, and those of you who may be watching us later today or sometime during this week on the recorded version on the church website. We're glad you're here worshiping with us.
Oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel. That mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship. A voice cries in the wilderness,
prepare the way of the Lord, Make God's way clear.
Lift up every valley, lower every mountain. We light this candle as a sign of the coming light of Christ. As the Lord has promised, in days to come the nations shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. The wolf shall lie down, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the lion and the fatling will lie down together. And a little child shall lead them. Let us walk in the light of the Lord. Amen.
Be seated, please. God does not want anyone to perish, but rather for all to come to repentance. Therefore, let us confess our sins, for God's salvation is at hand. Let us pray. Faithful God, we confess that we have not lived lives of holiness. We suffer from impatience, apathy, and grief. We have not been at peace. We repent of these offenses and turn to you in love. Forgive our iniquity and pardon our sins, that we may walk in righteousness to the glory of your name. We offer our prayers in the name of the one who saves us, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Brothers and sisters, by the mercy of Christ, your sins are forgiven, for salvation is at hand for all who turn to God. Amen. Now, since God has forgiven us in Christ, let us forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. And let us share the peace with one another. Peace, son. Peace be with you, Gail. Peace. Thank you.
seated. Let us pray. Mighty God, send your Holy Spirit to speak peace, that the good news of this age may be proclaimed through your word, which stands forever. Amen. Our first reading today is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what should I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades. When the breath of the Lord blows upon it, surely the people are grass. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our Lord will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up. Do not fear, say to the cities of Judah. Here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arms rule for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. Now please join me in the responsive reading of Psalm 85. You have been gracious to your land, O Lord. You have restored the good fortune of Jacob.
You have forgiven the iniquity of the people, and blotted out all their sins.
I will listen to what the Lord God is saying, for you speak peace to your faithful people and to those who turn their hearts to you.
Truly your salvation is very near to those who fear you, and that your glory may dwell in our land.
Steadfast love and faithfulness have met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. The Lord will indeed grant prosperity, and our land will yield its increase.
Righteousness shall go before the Lord, and shall prepare for God a pathway.
Thank you.
Our second reading comes from the Gospel according to Mark in the first chapter, the first 8 verses. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." This is the word of the Lord. Occasionally, he and his wife would sit down and just kind of review what their financial situation was. And they did this partly to see just that how it really was, and also that so that both of them would have an understanding of just what the financial situation was, and one wouldn't go off spending money that needed to be spent. As they would do this, they would sometimes take a look at their expenses, and even though things were good for them, they would take a look at the expenses and wonder if there was any way they could cut their expenses a little bit. Well, this one time when they were together, he was said to his wife that he had been reading a basic book on some maintenance that a car owner could do on his own car that would save money. He thought there were some things that he could do, particularly changing oil. He thought, well, that's a simple place to start. But he also knew that if he did that, he'd have to buy some things in order to get that done. So they agreed that this is something he could try. So he went out, he bought a set of ramps so that he could drive the car up on and he could get under. And then he bought a creeper, you know, that device in which the mechanic can lie down and slip under the car and keep off the floor. And then, of course, he had to buy an oil filter wrench. Well, the time comes. He's going to change the oil. He gets the ramp set up. He drives the car up on him. He gets underneath, takes the drain plug out, drains the oil, puts the plug back in, unscrews the filter, puts the new filter on, good and tight, just like it should be. And then as he goes to put the oil in, Yogi's out underneath, he discovers he forgot to buy any oil. Well, he says, that's no problem. He says, I can just run down to the store here. It's not far from here, and I'll get the oil. So he gets in his car, starts it, backs off the ramps, and of course he doesn't get too far until the engine stops. And needless to say, the damage that he caused to the engine would be far more expensive than many, many oil filters or oil changes that he would have done. Now, in spite of all the planning that he did, in this attempt to save money, it just didn't work out as he had planned. If he had paid close attention to the directions that were in the manual, he would have discovered at the top of the list was of the items needed was oil. And then in big, bold print was there, do not start the engine when there's no oil in it. The experience that this man had illustrates the importance of paying attention to directions. Barb and I, we will have discussions every so often when she wonders how to do something. And I say, well, did you read the manual? No. Maybe you guys have had a similar experience, or maybe you women have had a similar experience. But we both know it's important to read the instructions. Today, as we read the words of John the Baptist in Mark, we are reminded of the directions that John gave to the people and their importance to them, and that these directions are also aimed at us as we are preparing to celebrate the birth of the Christ child. You know, the appearance of John the Baptist was really important to the people in that day. In the past, God had spoken to the people through the prophets, you know, those individuals that had been designated by God to be God's spokesman to the people. Well, for a number of years, though, the voice of prophecy had been silent. And many did believe that the voice of prophecy would appear again when it was time for God to send the Messiah, that one who would save the people of Israel. Well, when John appeared, the people thought that he was the prophet. And they considered his appearance to be a signal from God that the coming of the Messiah was near and a new age was about to dawn for the people of Israel. And many who lived at that time saw John's role as one who would be preparing the way for the coming of the Messiah, the one they had longed for so long a period of time. Now Mark, the writer of this gospel, described the work of John using these words from the prophet Isaiah: prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Well, if you go back into Isaiah, you'll find that there's a little bit more there than what John or what Mark used in the gospel. Isaiah records it this way: in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground will become level, and the rough places a plain. Now for us, that doesn't mean a whole lot. But the people who lived in that day, those words were important. Because when a king visited part of his domain, a group of men would go ahead of him to make sure that the area was ready for his arrival. And among his duties, they were to give special attention to the roads. They were to fill the ruts and smooth the roads out so the king would have a smooth ride to wherever he was going. We see John the Baptist saw himself as one who would go ahead of the Messiah to prepare the way for him by calling the people to welcome him and to receive him as their new king. The role that John played as one who announced the coming of Jesus the Messiah reminds us of the responsibility that we Christians have at this time of the year. We are here to call people to prepare to celebrate the birth of the Christ child and what the birth of this child meant to the people, means to the people of the world. We are the ones who are to call those that have not welcomed Jesus in their lives to consider him to do so. But this responsibility of calling people to prepare to celebrate the birth of the Christ child and to welcome him into their lives is not always an easy one to fulfill. You may have had an experience similar to ones that I've had where you're in a room full of people and someone is trying to give directions to the people that are in that room. But with all the talking that is taking place and all the moving that is going on in that room, those directions are not heard. Well, it's difficult to call people to prepare to celebrate the birth of Christ because of all the noise and the activity of the Christmas season. And on occasion, the church has called people to reduce all this activity, all this noise, and focus on the birth. And the church has encouraged people to place less emphasis on things like parties and shopping and gift giving and Santa Claus. But as long as I can remember, all these things have happened. And they still take place. And most likely, they will continue in the future. Now, with the pandemic and what may be happening after the pandemic is under control, some of the ways that all that we celebrate Christmas change, but it will be there in some form or another. There will still be that noise and the activity. And all this means that we will have to put a little bit of extra effort into the telling of the Christmas story. Now, if we go back to that room that's full of people, you know, they're talking, they're moving around, and the person is trying to give the directions, that person keeps at it until the people hear what that individual is trying to say. Christmas traditions will continue. We need to accept that fact. Christians just have to make a little more noise so that people will hear the real Christmas story. You know, this is a time of the year when it's important to pay attention to directions. Those parents who will need to be putting toys together for their children, if they don't follow directions, they learn quickly they should have. Or for people who are getting these new various pieces of electronic devices who have never had such things before, they learn it's important to follow directions. And if someone who is doing some cooking wants to try something different this season, that individual knows the importance of following direction. And of course, if people are traveling, they know the importance of following those highway signs, or if they're flying, the importance of following what directions are in an airport terminal. If directions are not followed, these individuals could experience a number of problems. But these are not the only instructions that people should pay attention to at this time of the year. We, as Christians, are called to prepare the way of the Lord. We are instructed to prepare to celebrate the receiving of God's gift of Christ, child, into the world, and all that that means. We are to call those who are still, in the process of receiving this gift, to continue to do so. We are also to invite those who have not opened their lives to God's forgiving love to do so. Directions are important. Prepare the way of the Lord. Amen. Thank you. And now let us affirm our faith. Christ Jesus, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human kindness, and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, death on the cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess to the glory of God. Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. Be seated, please. As we prepare to end our time of prayer this morning, please keep these individuals in mind as you pray now, but also at other times during the day and the week. For those who are bereaved, the family of Royce Neal. Royce passed away on December 2nd, and I had gotten to know Royce back the first time when I was parish associate here, and she was not able to come to church at that time. And one of the things that kept her away was she had an allergy to perfume. And so that's why you've seen occasionally there's been that encouragement there, don't wear perfume to a worship service. And I always had good visits with Royce. I continue to remember Jean McKay and Becky Morgan, who also experienced some grief. Those that are still hospitalized, Marvel Pogorny, and Sonia Pohl, who Marvel still at Washington Regional, and Sonia at Mayo Clinic. Remember those, Barbara Sterp, who is in hospice, and she's still at Magnolia and Rogers. And those that are recovering. Now, Ed Farr, who is here for worship today, decided to take a little vacation this past week. Spent a few days at Mercy Hospital. And but Ed is here, he has recovered. He's doing all right. Also remember Don Rhodes. You remember Don had a little surgery on top of his head and a cancer place removed. I was talking to Kay Wednesday on their wedding anniversary and asked how Don was doing. And she said he's doing fine. He was going in that afternoon and they were going to close this up. And she said he'd had a PET scan and whatever scans you have. And he's clear of anything. So they're very grateful. And they say that made it a special wedding anniversary for them. Remember in your prayers, Art and Pat Keller, who have moved now to Houston, Texas, to be with family there. Also remember those dealing with cancer, Kathleen Linton, Karen Schneider, Jim Jennings, and Wilbur Schaefer. Those who are confined, Sally Vandegon, Joyce Johnson, Muriel Cross, Karen Prince, and Joy Phillips, Hope Kinney, Suzanne Moore, and Bob and Connie Rochelle. And now for our extended family, so you may not be aware, but you may remember Jim and Harriet White, who were members here for a number of years. They're former members. Jim had a massive stroke this past week. Do not know anything else at this point about how Jim is doing. Remember Tess and Sam Mack, who are Janelle Streichel's granddaughter and grandson-in-law, who are dealing with COVID-19. Jerry and Bev McDonald's grandson, Clayton, and son-in-law, grandson, in hospital in critical condition with blood infection, and the son-in-law with several blood clots. And Joyce, who is Bill Dieleman's son-in-law's sister, who is also dealing with cancer. And of course, Larry and Inga Streschley, who are our missionaries in the Democratic Republic the Congo. Let us pray. O God, we're in the time of the year when we sing of peace on earth and mercy mild. Yet we recognize how little our lives sometimes reflect these, your gifts. Forgive us and offer to us once again these gifts of love and tenderness that came to the world in the birth of your Son. Help us in the coming days to spend time preparing to celebrate the gift of the Christ child. Help us to share his spirit and his life with others. In the midst of the rush of the season, remind us that he came to save the world. Fill us with joy and gladness so that people may see in us the importance of the birth of your Son and the meaning that it has for them. During the celebration of the season, remember those who may not have much any joy present in their lives. Whether they're having physical or emotional issues, struggling to meet financial obligations, attempting to find adequate housing or to find money to pay their rent or their mortgage, or for those who are thinking about ending their life, we pray that in some way their situation may change and they may be able to experience the joy of the season now and in the days to come. Remember those on our prayer list. We pray for continued healing for those recovering from surgery or illness. We pray for hope for those dealing with cancer. We pray for peace for those suffering from the loss of someone important to them. And we pray that you will for comfort for those who will be may be feeling alone. We pray for our world, O God, especially all those places where there's turmoil. May peace come to those areas so that people may no longer have to suffer from the effects of political turmoil or war. We pray especially for those who are working in our hospitals and medical facilities who are having an extreme amount of work to do at this time, taking a great deal of energy. We pray that they will have the energy to do their work, and we pray that when they're off work, they will be able to have a good rest and a good sleep so as they continue to care for others. Hear our prayers that we offer in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We bring our gifts of God as a way to express our thanks to him and as a way to show our love as these funds are used in ministry here and in other places. Let us pray. Lord, we give you thanks that in the coming of Christ, your steadfast love and faithfulness have met, your righteousness and peace have kissed. May the gifts we offer this day lift up those in need and prepare the way of your salvation. Amen. You may remember last week, we began a congregational meeting that dealt with the nominations of people to serve as elders and deacons in the class to be elected. And we continue the meeting over to today. Because this is a continued meeting, we do not need to do an opening prayer. And the purpose of this meeting is simply to report the results of the one call vote that was taken on Tuesday morning. And the results of the meeting was that there were 98 people who voted yes, approving the slate. There was one that voted no. It's been interesting. As long as I can remember this year, whenever there's been an election, there's always one who votes no, which is okay. I just think it's an interesting thing. That's the only business we have today. And so I would entertain a motion to adjourn. Is there a second? All in favor say aye. Opposed? Let's close with prayer. Gracious God, we are thankful for the work that our nominating committee did, and we are especially thankful for these individuals who will be serving you in a new way in this congregation. But they will not only be serving you, they will be serving others outside of our congregation as the session plans and works with ministry, not only with people here, but people outside the walls of this building. We're grateful for them, and we ask your blessing upon them. Give them the wisdom they need to do their work. In Christ's name, amen. Any special announcements that need to be made? Hold on, Ron. We need to get a mic to you. And take your mask off when you do. No. Because I know John has a T-coil, and he can't hear you without a mic. So hang on. Can you hear him, John? Okay.
Jim White passed away last night. We just found out about Bevig, and it let us know that.
Okay. Did you all catch that?
Jim White, for you people that's been here a long time, you know, Jim and Harriet. He passed away last night in hospice.
Thank you, Ron. Appreciate that. Anything else that needs to be made? Don't forget, the schedule for Christmas Eve has changed this year. We will be meeting at 4 o'clock for worship here in the sanctuary. We will not be doing the lighting of the individual candles. Ronnie's leading the worship that day. There will be the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, again, using the little communion packet that we've used before. So make sure you sign up for that day, 4 o'clock. And one other announcement, the guys at the sound booth said, would you announce today we still need volunteers to work with them back there? It would be most helpful if any of you might be interested, or if you know of somebody who might be interested, let the guys know, and they will really appreciate that. With nothing else, our closing hymn is number 145. as we prepare to leave our time of worship here and to go out into the world, remember what Isaiah said and what Mark quoted. Our job is to prepare the way of the Lord. And as we do that, let us go with the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. And may God's joy and peace fill our hearts. Amen.